Conventionally, it's thought the only way that life on Earth in its microbial form can go completely extinct is at the hands of the sun. No current human activity can do it. As the sun's luminosity continues to increase, it will eventually result in a runaway greenhouse effect and the melting of the Earth's surface, which in turn will snuff out all life on Earth. No other disaster can do that. Mass extinctions, yes, they happen. But causing the extinction of even the microbes, there's only the sun that can do it, except one other, and it's technological. It's molecular nanotechnology, and it actually has several ways it could cause the extinction of all life on Earth. Molecular nanotechnology is a simple concept. You build tiny machines that can assemble molecules and materials on the atomic level. In reference to this, Richard Feynman once said that there's plenty of room at the bottom as to just how small we can go as far as manipulating materials. Only the atom itself presents a hard wall. Anything on its level or bigger can hypothetically be done. This holds great promise in just about every field. If it can be made to work, for example, it might provide something close to immortality. Imagine being able to manage the human body and repair it from within using tiny machines on a cellular level. Such a technology, if it proves viable, might even function as a kind of second immune system and fight disease in the bloodstream, or be used to augment the human body in many potential ways, from superintelligence to increased endurance and so on. It may even be able to preserve the brain after clinical death, giving more time to revive someone, or conceivably even revive that person on its own. Nanotech may also provide manufacturing possibilities far beyond anything we can do today, allowing for nanofactories and 3D printers on a level being able to approach something like a Star Trek replicator, but nothing close to as fast. The problem here is heat. You can't have your nanotechnological machines operating so fast that they melt themselves and whatever it is they're trying to make. So in this case, it will probably be very specialized manufacturing on atomic scales rather than a replicator that can print out a cup of Earl Grey. But with that heat generation comes a rather spooky possibility. Speculation about just what nanotechnology will eventually be capable of has already identified one major pitfall. It's the concept of the gray goo, and at its most basic, it essentially is where self-replicating nanotechnology consumes all biomass on Earth as it makes copies of itself. There's actually a term for this, ecophagy, where an entire biosphere gets consumed by something. The gray goo scenario is dependent on exponential growth and potentially consumption of the planet eventually. Estimates that it could do it within days, however, are thought to not be viable, but over years, it could happen, so long as you had no way to stop it. Perhaps even more disconcerting is the idea of using nanotechnology to create custom species. Say you created new plants that had no analog in nature, and these artificial plants escaped captivity and spread into the wild, outcompeting their natural counterparts, resulting in a mass extinction, or custom bacteria doing much the same. Ultimately, however, it's unlikely that anything like this would ever be built due to the dangers inherent to it. Rather, less capable nanotechnology that won't result in disaster is more likely. You don't need to equip a bulldozer with jet engines just to level a field. Even more spooky regarding molecular nanotechnology and its implications is the idea of a singleton. At its most basic, it isn't necessarily nanotechnological. Rather, it is the concept of an AI emerging or being purpose-built to essentially rule the world. The idea being that a computer with absolute power globally could make better, more rational decisions than any group of biological humans could. Such an emperor computer would be effectively immortal, able to make copies of itself and backups, and if left unchecked, could prevent any threat to its hegemony over humanity. The idea of a singleton can be taken a step further. If one were to emerge intentionally or accidentally, it may choose to obliterate not just humanity, but all life on planet Earth if it saw it as undesirable and a threat to its supremacy. Or we could become the singleton. If you were somehow able to get all humans in collective agreement on all ideas, we could form the singleton. This is basically impossible in natural humans. Disagreement is what we do. But through brain augmentation and the development of human superintelligence, this may become a concern. we would effectively turn into the Borg and bring about a very new reality to human existence. If as a singleton, we could even still be defined as human, as opposed to a hive mind. It's an interesting future indeed when Homo sapiens is no longer what we are, but rather what we descended from, and would constitute a completely new technological species. The benefits of a singleton could be enormous, in addition to the inherent risks. Such a superbrain would be inherently better at resource management, for example. It could also mitigate risks, such as nanotechnology, by preventing its development wholesale, deeming it too dangerous. On the other hand, however, it may employ nanotechnology for control purposes, or even artificial extinction purposes. The singleton concept augmented with molecular nanotechnology can in principle have another origin entirely, an alien singleton imposed on the galaxy. This is yet another scenario involving the zoo hypothesis. This is where the galaxy is ruled by a silent, immortal galactic dictator of some sort, perhaps descending from the first instance of intelligent life in the Milky Way, being perhaps billions of years older than us. This ancient power would simply allow for worlds to develop naturally, itself living in a kind of hibernation or virtual reality silently and undetectably in the universe, only waking up and intervening when necessary. One such intervention might be the signal that a civilization is getting close to molecular nanotechnology, and that could be seen as a threat to the entire galaxy. The dictator then wakes up and imposes itself on that civilization, either downshifting them or obliterating them. It may even use nanotechnology itself for this purpose, in the way a nation-state tries to maintain secrecy and control over new advanced weaponry here on Earth. This also opens up the way for a solution to the Fermi Paradox, where all alien technology is invariably undetectable because it's extraordinarily small and nanotechnological in nature. Even large amounts of nanotechnological self-replicating machines do not make much of a technosignature, because it may well simply appear as dust around a star. The behavior of such dust might be detectable and strange, but as for the nature of the dust itself, not so much. But those scenarios aside, what happens if we develop molecular nanotechnology as a tool, and how could it go wrong? Here, molecular nanotechnology offers some enormous benefits. It can be used to clean up oil spills and environmental disasters, alter an atmosphere's chemical makeup for terraforming, generate artificial rain, inject increased water vapor into the atmosphere, and cause global cooling by raising Earth's albedo by increasing cloud cover. It could consume microplastics, alter oceanic acidification, and many, many other uses if we can get the technology to work. But there's one thing that molecular nanotechnology could do that might be a problem in and of itself. It can heat an atmosphere. This would require self-replicating nanomachines filling the atmosphere, which is a problem in itself. Very high numbers of heat-producing machines filling the atmosphere could catastrophically warm it, even to the point of killing all surface life, and eventually subsurface life, resulting in the wholesale extinction of all life on Earth. The natural precaution here would be a kill switch, where the nanotechnology could be turned off, or otherwise controlled and kept from exponential growth, unless someone were looking to make a weapon. There are similarities between certain nanotechnology concepts and a fuel-air bomb. Likewise, in human history, whenever technology was developed that could end civilization, namely the nuclear weapons, multiple nations pursued them. This is a serious danger stemming from the development of nanotechnology because the weapons potential of it is enormous. But there is another option for nanotechnology that could lead to some very strange future possibilities. It's the technology's use in space. There are essentially two ways to use molecular nanotechnology in space, one inside habitats and one outside, in space itself. In space itself, it might be useful in construction or asteroid mining. This would be beyond odd-looking, some vague cloud surrounding an asteroid spitting out ingots every now and again, of extremely pure metals. 0.999 refinement of a metal has nothing on the potential absolute metal purity nanotechnological mining could produce by manipulating individual atoms. Inside a habitat, nanotechnology will prove useful in everything from growing food to managing the internal atmosphere of habitats, and even maintaining the habitat itself on a micro scale. But here again, nanotechnology can go every bit as wrong in a habitat as it can on a planet, and this leads to one last odd scenario. if humans continue to alter themselves and eventually begin to live entirely in space habitats, leaving Earth to largely return to nature, then you have the odd situation of humans taking different evolutionary paths based on what technologies they pursue unique to each habitat, say giant rotating O'Neill cylinders. This leads to many different divergent species of future augmented humans, which may not end up to be that great of a situation. If any of those species were to lose control of their nanotechnology and their habitat, they might meet their end, in which case the concept of extinction takes on an entirely new dimension. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently confident that AI will never amount to anything. Uh-oh.
John, why are your passwords all the same thing?
I only have so much memory, and besides, the possum can't speak English. He'll never figure them out. Wait a minute, my bank balance just dropped. And it just did it again. Anna, what is this charge from Randy's super intelligent AI circuit company? And now there's one from Scratchy's Opossum Neutron and Bone Food Emporium. Yeah, I wonder who around here eats neutrons and bones. Anna, what's going on here?
I don't know, John. I certainly don't know your password. Oh yes, you like that. What do you need two for?
Yeah, this must be some kind of bank mistake. I guess I'll just call the bank sometime. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.